When I start the second day of this neuromod simulation workshop, it'll be a long day, ahead of us, and we'll start with the invited keynote speak, a speech by our invited speaker, Markus Diesmann from Jülich in Germany. So, yeah, you already know him, so.
Thank you, Antonio. I'm sorry for the trouble I caused yesterday. This was an unfortunate sequence of events that I told Antonio in detail, but will not repeat here. The bottom line is that the plane had a leakage in a fuel pipe, and when it was fixed, it was too late to start from Frankfurt because planes cannot take off at the night, and so I had to stay the night there. But now I'm here. So today I would like to talk about a multi-area model at cellular resolution as a data integrator. Some of you know already part of the material, but today I want to give this a bit of a different angle especially for discussing some services that maybe the SimLab of Neuromod can provide to the community. And so one important point always is the question of what kind of benefit does society and the community as at large has of such endeavors as Neuromod. So I will start the talk with a bit of a different introduction that we recently developed to highlight a bit of this. So the motivation here is to integrate the experimental data from different levels and different laboratories and to investigate the multiscale dynamics in the resting state. There is a lot of randomness in the description of the network structure here, but this does not imply that the natural system is necessarily random. In this case, it just reflects our ignorance. And the aim of this work is to provide the community with cortical network models as building blocks for further functional studies, and to also to provide the digitized workflow from experimental data to the model specification, because we think that in these complex models, this is of the same relevance as the model itself. We'll go into this during the talk. So these slides are now on our new motivation. You have all heard about the hype of artificial intelligence and deep learning, which is presently going on. And of course, this excels on many tasks, but there are also tasks that artificial intelligence systems cannot do today and where the brain is still unbeaten. And this are, for example, tasks where you need to learn from just a few examples. So you have probably only one chance in your life to learn to stop at a red traffic light. You cannot test this 1,000 times. And also the eye-hand coordination that we are seemingly doing is also still not well developed in robotics. So there is still the need to understand brain function better in order to develop new principles for artificial intelligence. And on the technical side, the modern AI algorithms that we have, they work well on present-day computers because they have computationally dense computations, and that's what our hardware today, like general-purpose graphics cards and so on, are built for. So this works well, but it comes at a very high price, and this is energy consumption. If you consider that our brain needs about 20 watts, that's a small light bulb, and our computers, supercomputers, require 2 megawatts, then there is quite some discrepancy here, and it's presently unclear where this discrepancy comes from. And another constraint that we see is that the end of Moore's law seems to be approaching, and Moore's law is not a law of nature, but is something that has held true for the last decades, and this is that every few years, the number of transistors that you can place on a square millimeter of substrate has doubled. but this is no longer the case. So the idea here would be to derive from brain science principles of the brain that can be used for building novel computers. And this then, these two aspects then raise the question, is there any hope that we can achieve this? And this hope is reflected here on the right side. So here you see a photo of a stained nerve cell. Here is the scale bar. This that shows you that the cell body here is, has about a diameter of 20 micrometers. And below this, you see a photograph of a modern transistor. And there's also a scale bar here. And the scale bar here is 20 nanometers, meaning that the structures that we can produce in technology are three orders of magnitude smaller than the relevant structures in the brain. So the size of the structures in the brain does not seem to be pose a problem. And also, the number of elements is under control. If you count the number of neurons in the cortex of the human brain, where the higher brain functions are supposed to be implemented, then you have there about 10 to the power of 10 neurons. But this is matched by the number of transistors in a modern processor. So also the number of elements does not seem to be a fundamental problem. A fundamental problem is the dense wiring. Here you see another photograph of into the cortex, and this time the axons, the output structures of the neurons, are colored. The white blobs are blood vessels. The scale bar here is again 20 microns, and what you see is that the tissue is completely fully packed with cables. There are about 3 kilometers of cables in 1 cubic millimeter of brain, and every nerve cell receives 10,000 of these inputs. And this connection density is something that no technology today can achieve. I will show you during the talk what the consequences of this are. However, we should not forget that we have three orders of magnitude free to play with. So the principal barrier here comes from the fact that our semiconductor technology is essentially still 2D, whereas the brain is wired in 3D. So the main neuroscientific work presented in this talk was carried out by Max Schmidt, who is now a postdoc at Riegen BSI. Sascha van Albada, who is a group leader at our institute in the group of theoretical neuroanatomy, and Alexander van Meegen, who is a new PhD student who recently entered the project, and this work is supported by the Human Brain Project. So the simulation technology that we are using to carry out our simulations is developed in the framework of the NEST initiative that is producing the NEST simulator, but also trying to systematically publish the technology that is behind this software. We are doing teaching and training, as you know, around the world, for example, also at the famous Lascon School in Brazil. And the next major event will be the NEST conference in Aarhus, Norway in June 24th, which is a good date because this is around the time of the year when the sun never settles in Norway. So it's a very interesting place. So in the few months, we discovered that there is often some confusion in the community on what these simulation engines like NEST are good for. And for this reason, I prepared the following two slides. So the situation is that there are several general purpose simulation engines like NEST and Neuron, and we can simulate many different models as indicated here with one simulation engine. And this is a very good situation because that means that we can very well validate this code and optimize this for the target computer system. Yes, and there's also another relationship, and this is that some models can be implemented on several simulation engines. For example, this network model that is well known to you and that I'm going to talk about can be implemented in the simulation code Nest, but also in Neuron and also in on neuromorphic hardware. And this is also a fortunate scenario because this means that we can cross-validate the result on the highest level. This is just a brief characterization of the model. I don't want to go much into detail because you know it. It's a model of a cubic millimeter of cortex with 100,000 neurons, 1 billion synapses, and only 2 neuron populations in each layer. This model already integrates a large set of experimental data and makes some interesting predictions. For example, that the spike rate of the inhibitory neurons is consistently higher than the excitatory ones. This as a typical simulation result is shown here, where this is time, and you imagine the surface of the brain like here, and then we are looking 1 millimeter into the depths of the cortex. The spikes of the neurons are marked as dots, and in order to guide your eye, I have colored the spikes of the excitatory neurons in blue and of the inhibitory neurons in red. And here they are sorted according to cell type. Of course, in the brain, they would naturally be completely intermixed. And this model was a success because we managed to publish the executable model description in databases like Open Source Brain so that other people could start to use this. And as a consequence, so this was picked up, and several other studies emerged that are actually using this model. I think the count right now is at 17, and this is exactly what we wanted to achieve. But this model can also be heavily criticized because we are representing all the synapses that are connecting the neurons in this model. But if you look at the level of an individual neuron, then it receives only 50% of its synapses from inside this cubic millimeter, and 50% are coming from outside. So you could as well make the statement that this model is heavily under constraint. And you see these artifacts, for example, by looking at the power spectrum of the spiking activity. This is in our model completely flat, while we know that in nature there is substantial power at the low frequencies. Now, if you consider our microcircuit sitting here, and you would now zoom out a bit in the cortex, then you would see that a different structure emerges at the level of cortical areas. Here, the network exhibits spatial structure. The further two neurons are apart, the less likely it is that they are connected. And then if you zoom out to the level of the whole brain, then, for example, in the human brain, the structure falls apart into about 100 of these areas, but each area is connected only to 10 others, meaning that on the highest level, there's again room for an interesting recurrent network, so that we have to speak about a network of networks. So in order to overcome these problems, we now want to go to the brain scale and to construct more self-consistent models. But there's also another reason for doing this, and this is that our experimental colleagues obtain a lot of measures at the brain scale, like EEG, MEG, and fMRI, and of course we want to relate our model results to their measurements. So, and the system we decided to start with is the macaque visual cortex. Not so much because we are interested in vision or we are interested in the macaque, but just because in this system we have a lot of anatomical data available. The full system would contain 32 areas and have a total of 1 billion neurons. This is just possible to simulate on the largest supercomputers that are available today, but much too large for any practical production work. So as a first step, we decided to place one of our microcircuits in each of the 32 areas. And then we are ending up with a network of the size of a few million neurons, which still requires a supercomputer, but only a minor fraction of a supercomputer, so we can really carry out research with this system. And then the plan is to later scale this up to the full size. Now, the areas are not looking the same in their detailed structure. If you go up the visual hierarchy, then the neuron density declines, whereas the synapse density stays the same. So meaning that the in-degree of the neurons goes up when you go up the hierarchy, and of course we need to respect this in our model. And another thing we need to know is, of course, the connectivity between areas. And here we are fortunate that we have axonal tracing available as a technique, which is invasive and therefore cannot be used in the human. And this works in the following way, that you inject a dye into a particular area. And this dye has the property that it goes retrograde up the axon, and then is coloring the synapses in the source area. And thereby we can then, if we do this carefully, get also a quantitative impression on the connectivity between these two areas. And we can also highlight different connectivity patterns that are distinguishing feedforward from feedback connection. And these data are available in a database that is called the COCOMAC database. These are partly very old data, so they are often only 0 or 1, but there are also more recent data from the lab of Henry Kennedy. And this lab, in addition, found a principle, and this is that connections between areas become weaker if they have a larger distance to each other. This they called the exponential distance rule. And this principle allowed us to compile an integrated data set of the area-to-area connectivity that is also quantitative. Now, we not only need to know whether the areas are connected, but also from which layer the connections originate and into which layer they are going. And this we can do on the basis of a relation between the different neuron densities in the different areas and the connectivity patterns of feedforward and feedback connections. This is reflected here, and this then allows us to specify this even for connections that have not been measured. And there's an additional slight complication, and this is that these axonal tracing labeled synapses, but this does not mean that the cell body is sitting in the same layer as the synapse. So this also has to be accounted for, and the result is then a very detailed connectivity matrix that is not only area resolved but also layer resolved. And before we do any simulation, we can do some graph analysis on this network. This is just one example here to convince ourselves that this structure is not completely crazy. Here you see a result of clustering, and the clusters that are emerging here are functionally meaningful. So in blue here, you see the ventral pathway, as neuroscientists call it. This is the pathway on which it is evaluated what is in the scene, and the red network is the dorsal pathway that determines where an object is in the scene, and there are also a few other clusters emerging. And so this compiled data set we published then in a anatomical paper, an anatomical journal that's called Brain Structure and Function. And this is just to show you that theory applied to neuroanatomy is now becoming fancy. There are words in the literature like computational connectomics and predictive connectomics that are trying to find rules of the connectivity between certain units that have not been measured. So, but we don't only want to study the anatomy, we want to carry out simulations of this system. And here you see raster diagrams for three different areas in the same format as I have shown you before for the microcircuit. They look a bit different, but what is more important is are these diagrams here that are showing the summed up population activity in the three areas. And here we now see a new feature, and this is that there are slow time scales appearing. We have phases where the activity is quite high, then drops down, stays there for some time, and then comes up again. So this is the signature here for a metastable system. And this is creating the slow time scales that we were missing in the isolated microcircuit. And this you can now appreciate here, where we see the power spectrum of the spiking activity. The yellow curve here is from an experimental data set from the awake monkey, and in blue and in black you see the simulation result plotted on top, and you can recognize that this works quite well. And in on the right panel you see the distribution of spike rates in the system, and what you can see here is that the black curve is the simulation result. Experimental data are below, so there's a quite nice fit. And yes, sure.
What's the explanation for the high power in the gamma range?
This one here.
Yeah.
That's a good question. So we don't know. We don't know where this comes from. It's in this case it's not seen in the experimental data. It's probably due to the fact that there is still too much synchrony in our model. That could be, yeah. Or artificially destroy it. Yeah. And so the red curve and the blue curve here are for different simulations, where in the red curve the inter-area coupling what we made weaker than for the black curve, and for the blue curve we made the coupling stronger. You see that both of these curves don't fit the experimental data very well. So that means that the interaction strengths that we have chosen for is not arbitrary. You really need this metastable state in order to explain the data. And here is a bit a more complex analysis. Here we wanted to know what the sequence of propagation of activity is in this network, still in the resting state. And for this, we analyzed the shift of the peak in the cross-correlation function between the spiking activity in two areas, and then tried to sort them in a matrix with as few violations of order as possible. And then you find out that in this resting state, you have a propagation of activity from the higher visual areas down to the lower ones. So, and this is, this is plausible here because that fits to experimental data that see this kind of propagation in the resting state, which of course is completely reversed once you have a stimulus. Then the propagation of activity is of course the other way around, from the early visual areas to the later ones. And here finally is a first comparison of our simulation data with data from functional fMRI. So here monkeys were put in a scanner, and in this matrix you see the correlation of the fMRI signal between pairs of areas. And as a comparison, we correlated the synaptic input currents of into our areas in our model, and the outcome is that these two matrices, although there are obvious discrepancies, are already closer than the fMRI data would be to our anatomical metrics. So here the dynamics really adds something to the explanatory power. And if you look at the agreement that is reached, then in this setting it's probably as good as it can be, because the discrepancy between these two matrices is not larger than the discrepancy between the matrices of the six monkeys tested. So that also means that if we want with these methods come closer to the real brain, we probably have to individualize the models eventually. So these model results were published in a traditional scientific paper in PLOS CB. However, it was clear to us that this would not be enough to make our colleagues really making use of this model. Therefore, we now went a different way than last time, where we just put the executable model description into a database. This time, we used the software platform GitHub to deploy code. And so people of you who are involved in software development probably know this. So this is a software platform that allows you to set up a formal code review, to work collaboratively on code, or in this case, model descriptions. If you want to reuse this model, you can just do a fork and set up your own project, and you can also report issues and problems with this model. So this we view as an example of a future collaboration platform, as for example the Human Brain Project in Europe tries to build. It's certainly not optimized for our purpose, but it's a start. And what it also gives you is that you can document with text and figures of what your model is supposed to be. But while we figured out that maybe the most interesting point about our model is not the executable model description itself, but way how we got from the experimental data to the executable model description. Because experimental data are coming in, or a researcher wants to adapt the model to a different species, then of course the experimental data would change or would be enhanced. And therefore, we tried to digitize the whole workflow from the experimental data to the executable model description, and made this also a part of this GitHub repository. And the tool that we are using for expressing this is called SnakeMake. This is thing like a Python-based that has been developed in the systems biology community. Here is a paper that is describing this. And the this code looks then very much like you are used to from Makefiles, maybe on a bit of a higher level. And it also allows us to recreate from this SnakeMake file all the figures of the three publications that are disabled. So once you have downloaded the model code, you can convince yourself that everything is in order by rerunning it and reproducing our figures. In addition, we created movie that you find at this place here on YouTube that is describing the model and how to use the repository. In order to simulate this model, we are using supercomputers as the ones shown here. But the model would also run on an HPC cluster, and the code is set up like this, that you can also downscale the model and run it on smaller systems. In order to make these simulations efficient, we are continuously developing the simulation code as shown on this slide, and this is quite popular in the field of exascale computers. But I'm bringing up this slide because I want to prepare you for the next one that shows you that maybe we are reaching here a fundamental limitation. So in our recent work on the simulation technology, we were able to reduce the simulation time from about half an hour to 5 minutes. This is quite substantial, of course, but for just 1 second of biological time. So meaning to simulate 1 second of biological time of a large network takes 5 minutes. This means we can look at the spiking activity a bit, but any interesting questions of learning and plasticity are at this scale, of course, completely out of the question. And it might be that supercomputers are never fast enough to really achieve real-time or actually accelerated computing as we would like to have it. And therefore, we are in parallel trying out a different route. And here I'm now coming back to the initial slides of my talk. And this is the idea to build computers that are built according to principles of the brain. Here are two systems as they are presently being built in Europe. This is the BrainScale systems in Heidelberg, and this is the Spinnaker system in Manchester. You see here two figures superimposed. In my presentation, original one, they would appear one by one. And what this is supposed to show is that this system was completed on Friday 2 weeks ago, where the number of racks here is now completed so that it achieves 1 million processing cores. And we have spent the last 4 years in trying to port this microcircuit model to this Spinnaker system. In the process, the operating system software of the system was much improved. So we now have a situation where we can run this model successfully on the Spinnaker system. And this is a breakthrough because this means that we now have a neuromorphic system where we can simulate networks at their natural density. And because we modeled the full microcircuit, this means that every larger biologically realistic network is necessarily less densely connected and therefore should be easier to simulate. But this study also showed us some limitations that we presently have. The first one is that the energy consumption of the neuromorphic system is still not better than the one of our HPC cluster. The reason for this is that we had to slow down the neuromorphic system quite a bit. And the other limitation is that if we invest all the hardware resources that we have available in our HPC cluster, we can still faster simulate than with a neuromorphic system. So there are no fundamental limitations here, but it still means that there is a lot of development work to do. And I showed you this picture of this very large Spinnaker machine in Manchester. And so to set this into perspective, we are right now only using less than 1% of this neuromorphic computer. So we really have to learn how to scale up the networks on this system. This study found a lot of interest in the news, But this also told us the responsibility that we have towards society, and I think that's another aspect that Neuromat should take care of, that you accidentally then get headlines like this, and even worse. So we have to be very careful in not to oversell our results. So finally, I want to point you to this workshop, which is already happening next week, and this is specifically dedicated to improve the user-level documentation for the Nest simulation software, but also for the Spinnaker and BrainScales hardware systems. So if you have any ideas about what is wrong with the user-level documentation of these systems, please contact us. We are now making the plans for improving this that will then be implemented over the next years in the final phase of the European Human Brain Project. So this is my summary. I presented you cortical models as building blocks and platforms for further studies. I argued for the need for brain scale models. In particular, I showed you a full-scale multi-area model of macaque visual cortex. Our simulation code is ready for the area of post-petascale computers. Networks of the size of the cortical microcircuit can now run on neuromorphic computing systems. And actually, maybe neuromorphic computing is required for real-time or accelerated computing. But then, in the context of the SimLab here, the two last points are very important to me. And this is that this reproducibility and reusability of our results requires research and resources, and that the digitization of the involved workflows is probably the next step that we have to address in successfully publishing our models. Thank you very much.
Please, I have a question related to the functional connectivity of the mic. How these networks are sensitive to the parameters of the model? And also, how you go from the dynamics to the resting state networks in your model?
Yeah, so in the two matrices I showed you, we just compared the summed up synaptic current in our integrate and fire models to the fMRI signal. Yeah, this is of course a very crude comparison only, but if you look into the paper that I presented here, then there are also results where we connected our spiking model to a model of the Bolt signal, and then computed the functional connectivity on the Bolt signal and compared this to the experimental data, and you can see in the paper the results. Now, with respect to sensitivity of parameters, I had this one slide where I showed you that the coupling strengths between the areas is really influencing the distribution of the spike rates very much. So if it's you need to be in the metastable state to really capture the distribution of the spike rates. And this also holds for the functional connectivity. So if you mess this up, then you will not have this fit. Here we have plotted the agreement between the two matrices as a function of the coupling strengths between the areas. And here you see that that is first quite low, then it goes up. And when the coupling strength is too high, then it goes down again. And this part where the correspondence is good corresponds to this metastable state.
Well, you're arguing for the multi-scale model, and you said that you can simulate at lower scales given the power of the computer you're using. So how does this result scale with your number of neurons in the network? Do you expect, if you simulate smaller networks, to have the same kind of result, or to simply break down at some scale of you know, modeling of number of neurons and synapses?
So we have an earlier paper that I didn't show here. And this makes the following statement, that if you look at the first order statistics of the spiking data, like the spike rates, then it's very easy to downscale the networks by orders of magnitude and maintain exactly the same result. However, if you go to higher order statistics, already cross correlations, then you have very tight boundaries in which you can scale the network without perturbing the second order statistics. So basically, there seems to be no way out.
All right. And how does this compare to the real brain then? I mean, do you think that from this knowledge that you can see in your model, that scaling down, you at some point you break down the cross-correlation, for instance, how does this compare to the real brain? Do you think that in the
brain... In terms of function, you mean?
Yeah, right. In terms of function.
Yeah.
There is a certain scale for the brain that it would break down the, for instance, high-level functional cognitive functions.
Oh, yeah. Oh, okay. So this I don't know. So my statement was first was only holding to the measurements that we take from the brain. Yeah, and here I pointed out the second order statistics, meaning cross correlations, because this is very important for many measures that experimentalists like to take. So if you, for example, think about the local field potential or the EEG, this is basically only picking up fluctuations, and the fluctuations are completely determined by the second order statistics. So if you get this wrong, you will also get the measurements wrong. Yeah. So in terms of network functions, I think that once we understood how a particular part of the brain works, we can well represent this with less units than these millions and billions of synapses. Yeah. And this is why we hope that our work, which is very much bottom up, just building up the networks according to anatomical constraints, is now a substrate on which other researchers can test their top down ideas. Yeah. So whenever you have now an idea how a part of the circuit would work, you could try to implement this into our model, so that you are sure that you're compatible with the anatomical constraints. That's the idea.
Concerning the reproducible research part, how much of the code depends on Python? Because my experience practicing for 13 years reproducible research is that Python above basic Python is a nightmare if you want to keep codes running for more than 6 months.
Yeah, I fully agree with you. That may depend on the fact that we have maybe similar age. So the Python interface to our simulation code we developed in order to connect to the computational neuroscience community, because it's kind of the standard language now used. But this modeling aspect, the Python description is just setting up the simulation. So as soon as the simulation engine starts to run, it's completely done on the C++ level with a very few commands.
So you have a model that implements space. So you have this spatial connection between the areas. Do you observe traveling waves in the way that people do when they use, say, Utah rays? You know that today,
yeah.
People.
Yeah. So that's a very good question. So this level of organization, I basically had to skip in this model, right? So because we have the 32 areas, but each area is only represented by one of these microcircuits, and in the microcircuit, we don't have this local spatial organization. Yeah. So inside the areas, there are no traveling waves, and we have not seen this. Yeah. So we see this propagation of activity from higher areas to lower areas. Yeah. So in parallel in our lab, we are developing a model that is representing like 4 by 4 millimeter of cortical surface in order to fit to the Utah array, as you mentioned. And there we are representing the spatial organization, and this produces also traveling waves.
Okay, so if there's no further questions, let's thank the speaker again.
Thank you.
Let's go.